Hello everyone, let's talk about the osteology of the posterior neck. So looking at this articulated skeleton from an anterior view, perhaps slightly lateral as well, we can tell that that's the orientation from the sternum here. The sternum is colloquially known as the breastbone, and what we can see are the articulations of all of the ribs coming down to meet the sternum along the midline. We can also see the clavicle, which is the solid attachment of the upper limb to the axial skeleton, and posteriorly here, we can see the vertebral column coming down. Let's clear some of this stuff out of the way and discuss some of the features that we want to see. So going back to the ribs, I'm outlining, well, let me just label. There's rib one. Rib one is coming from the C-spine. It's coming out laterally around, and it's articulating with the manubrium of the sternum. So the manubrium is this part right there, the most superior element of the sternum. Rib 2, R2 here, is also coming from the C spine out and around. And it's articulating at the sternal angle. That's the part of the sternum that sits between the manubrium and the body of the sternum. Now, if we were to create an imaginary plane here, erase all of that, and that imaginary plane were to consist of the anterior aspect of this vertebral body and the medial border of rib one, as well as the manubrium here. That would be the superior thoracic aperture, also known as the thoracic inlet. So if you can imagine, this space here provides continuity for the structures of the neck with the structures of the thorax. So this includes, but isn't limited to, things like the trachea, the esophagus, the contents of the carotid sheath, nerves, and other neurovasculature. So taking a moment to see our first rib, close up and personal. So this is the aspect, this would be the head of the rib, which would articulate with the C-spine. This concave border is the medial border. So this would be the thoracic inlet here, or at least part of that thoracic inlet. And this part here, this rough part, would be the portion of the rib that would attach to the hyaline cartilage that would come out to attach to the manubrium. This out of the way for us. It's a little difficult to discern, but if you can see this kind of raised area here, that raised area is the scalene tubercle, and that's where the anterior scalene muscle is going to attach. So if you recall the spatial relationships of the vessels of the root of the neck. Anteriorly is the subclavian vein. Posterior to the anterior scalene is the subclavian artery. And then also running down in this area would be actually right upon the scalene muscle and then going into the thoracic aperture, the superior thoracic aperture, would be the phrenic nerve, and also running down through that superior thoracic aperture would be the vagus nerve as well. So these grooves here, let's erase this so that we can perhaps outline them and be a little more precise here. So coming back, there is our tubercle, and this shallow depression here would be the groove for the subclavian vein, and this shallow depression here would be the groove for the subclavian artery. Sometimes these grooves are very, very subtle. Let's move on to the elements of the vertebral column. That would be the vertebrae. So there are three types of vertebrae. There are cervical, thoracic, and lumbar vertebrae. Cervical vertebrae are of the neck, so they comprise the C-spine, and there are seven of them. Cervical vertebrae are readily identifiable because they have these transverse foramina. They are the only vertebrae that contain transverse foramina, and it's through these transverse foramina that the vertebral arteries and veins will run. We call them transverse foramina because they pierce through what would be the transverse process of the vertebrae. The transverse processes of the cervical vertebrae can be quite variable. These ones are bifid, so there are two. That leaves us with an anterior and a posterior tubercle for the transverse process here. When we look at the vertebrae, we can identify directionality. This is a superior view of a cervical vertebrae, and I'll just write anterior here and posterior here. I can tell that this is the anterior portion because the body of the vertebrae, which I'm outlining here, is anterior, and the spinous process is located posteriorly. So coming off of the body is the vertebral arch. So that would be everything that I'm outlining here. So that's the vertebral arch. That vertebral arch consists of two pairs of structures. So starting there at the body, running up to there, that would be the pedicel. And then beyond the pedicel to the midline here of the spinous process would be the lamina, plural laminae. So vertebral arch equals pedicel plus laminae. That vertebral arch is going to surround, with the help of the posterior aspect of the body, an empty space called the vertebral canal, or vertebral foramen, or spinal canal. That would be this region here that I'm circling. And it's in this region here that we would find the spinal cord surrounded by the meninges. So when we look at the C-spine here, this is a nice way of viewing it. This has been sagittally sectioned, surrounding the C-spine here. The skull sits atop the C-spine. There's an articulation there that we'll see. But in between the bodies of the vertebrae are intervertebral discs. These are fibrocartilaginous discs. Then off to the left here, we have a representation of an intervertebral disc there that allows for cushioning and free articulation of these vertebrae so that we can have lateral anterior flexion of the C-spine as well as extension of the C-spine. And these intervertebral discs go all the way down to the lumbar region. So we could even find them between the fifth lumbar vertebrae and the sacrum. Laterally here, this isn't on your list for this session, but we can see it here, is an intervertebral foramen. These intervertebral foramina allow spinal nerves to exit from that vertebral canal. So they can go off and innervate things or bring back afferent messages as well. We have a couple of special vertebrae to discuss, and let's just keep our same orientation here. So that's anterior, and here is posterior. This lovely vertebra that you're looking at is C1, also known as the atlas. Atlas, if you recall from your Greek mythology, was the demigod who held up the earth on his shoulders, and C1 holds up the skull on its shoulders. So C1 is so readily identifiable because most of its body is missing. So its body would be located around there. And there is no body here. So what actually happens is early in development, what would be the majority of the body delaminates from the rest of the vertebrae, and it attaches to the body of C2, and it becomes the dens, D-E-N-S, or the odontoid process. So let's take a look at that. So this is C2, the axis, and right there is our dens. And that dens allows for a pivot motion. So we can have some lateral pivoting. So you can wag your head to the left and right so as to indicate a negative response to a person when you're saying no to them. Complements of the dens. So these two vertebrae here form what's known as the Atlanto-axial joint, and we can see the dens here nestled in position. We can see those spaces prescribed by the vertebral foramina, which would allow for the spinal canal to move freely. We can also see here the spinous process of this particular C2 is bifid. A bifid spinous process is something that's unique to cervical vertebrae. So you'll usually see non-bifid spinous processes of thoracic and lumbar vertebrae, for instance. But these are quite common in the cervical region. So we've seen the osteology of the root of the neck with the superior thoracic aperture. The manubrium, ribs 1 and 2, and how they articulate with the sternum. And we've seen the features of cervical vertebrae and even special cervical vertebrae like C1 and C2, or the atlas and the axis. Thank you for your time.